Hi, and welcome to the Nuit report for the week of June 26th. I'm April Shaley of aprilsastrology.com, which has a brand new look right now. I'm so pleased and thrilled with my with the new website. It's much more user-friendly, which was really important to me so that you can navigate it with more ease. And it just has a whole new sort of cleaner feel to it. So I hope that you'll be able to come to the site and visit and explore aprilsastrology.com and let me know what you think. And while you're there, maybe get a reading or sign up for one of the webinars. I have a number of webinars now that are recorded, so you can take them on demand. So beginning astrology, intermediate astrology, tarot, magic, spell work, all sorts of stuff. So you can enjoy that while you're there. So here we are. It's the Sun is conjunct Mars, and in true fashion of Sun conjunct Mars, just as I began this Nuit report, the guys who mow the lawn have arrived to weed whack and mow the lawn. So you may hear that as a soundtrack throughout this report. I'm going to go with it. I'm going to go with it because I'm going to, that's going to be our example of how to manage this energy, because Sun and Mars in Cancer is prone to irritability and in very intense, volatile emotions that can sort of erupt. And we feel a sense of maybe protectiveness over our territory. Cancer is about security and territory and home, our home base, our tribe, our feelings, our instincts. Cancer is the sign of the Great Mother, the archetypal Great Mother, the Great Goddess. And so we're dealing with, perhaps at this time, the theme of feminine anger, feminine rage. I was just having a conversation with a friend about this the other day, about her project. And she's exploring some of these themes via performance and discussion. And once I thought about this astrology, I thought, well, of course this is coming up now, because this is the kind of energy that we're talking about right now. And of course, we love to romanticize female anger, right? We love things like Terminator, or we like to see women who are like looking sexy, you know, as long as they're young and muscly and they have like skimpy clothes on, you know, it's great to see a woman with a sword or a gun or something. It's very, very exciting. But when it's like your spouse in the kitchen in your sweatpants, you know, angry at you about the dishes, or you're on a date and that goes awry or something like that, this is kind of a little different. Maybe we feel a little different about that. So, but this is coming up. This is coming up. You know, the visions of, you know, how we relate to that. If we're sort of dealing with it in a voyeuristic way on stage and screen, or we're able to actually engage, you know, and hold space for the kinds of issues and the kinds of intelligence that may be present or expressed through feminine anger at this time, and feminine aggressiveness, feminine assertion. And that's not just for women, that's also within men as well, you know? Men can sort of get a sense of their own feminine nature a number of ways, but one way is the kinds of images of women that are interesting and compelling and attractive. That's a really good sort of gauge and reflection for the state of one's own inner feminine. And women and men can kind of get a sense of what kind of state that part of ourselves is in by how we feel. Because the feminine nature is our feelings and our intuition and our our emotional guidance system is sort of feminine, energetic system in our psyches and bodies. So we've got that. We've got Venus in Leo conjunct Jupiter, and this is going to make a completed, like a perfect conjunction at the same time as the full moon next week. So I'm going to include our discussion of the full moon. It doesn't happen till next Wednesday, but it's very powerful, it's very important, and it's part of this week that I sort of include in this report. So that full moon is going to happen at 9 degrees Capricorn. Capricorn is the sign of manifest accomplishment. It's the sign of being able able to use one's resources, one's talents, one's friends, one's colleagues, anything, talents, money, whatever you've got, to use it to accomplish a goal. Capricorn is the sign that goes up the mountain and tries to get to the summit of the mountain, and that's kind of the goal for Capricorn. We get really wrapped up in that, though, as you know, we get wrapped up in Capricorn energies. And so the antidote for getting too intense and serious in Capricorn land is humor and remembering the trickster energies. Capricorn can be very hierarchical, and there's rules, and there's laws, and there's doop-de-doop-de-doop-de-dee, you know, like everything has to be a certain way. And the trickster side to our psyches and trickster people that show up in our lives, maybe we ourselves are tricksters, challenge these. The sacred clown sort of challenges the seriousness of accomplishment and status and goals, and I've got to, you know, achieve by the time I'm, you know, 30, 40, 50, you know, I've got to get this done. You know, trickster's like, do you? Is that right? Well, we're taking ourselves very seriously. Let me push this button. Now, this is kind of dangerous business right now, because I was just talking about this Sun-Mars conjunction in Cancer, Capricorn's opposite sign, and that will be in play still next week. It's, you know, they're separating a bit, but it's still going to be in play next week with this, you know, the full moon is it is an illuminating lunation. It brings the energy up, right? So anything with the Sun-Mars conjunction is very volatile. So the full moon is going to bring these energies, you know, up into, you know, sort of whip it up. You know, like we know when a full moon happens that this is the time when things like get intense for people. Weird, people behave strangely, our emotions get really intensified, and again, you know, moon's going to be opposite, that moon and sun opposition, that is what the full moon is. And it's also this balance of masculine and feminine. The moon being the receptive, the sun being the masculine, or the sort of outgoing, the will. So we're getting, with this full moon next Wednesday, a very powerful spotlight on right use of will as it connects to how we feel, our emotions. So sometimes we get this idea, you know, that we have to, you know, like there's a steeliness to will, and that you have to sort of, there can be occasion for that, I'm sure, but what I'm challenging in this moment, being trickster myself, what I'm challenging in this moment is the assumption, let's just play with it, that will is about steeliness, and it's about, and it's about, like, no pain, no gain, and, like, you have to just do it, and no matter what you feel, you override that, you don't let your emotions get in the way, you know, you just achieve and go, team, go, and it doesn't matter if you hurt yourself, you know. What I'm going to say is that I'm going to challenge that and say that will is actually well informed by how we feel. So when we're discordant in our emotional self, we're probably, that might be a really good signal that we're kind of not directing our will in the right way for us. So this moment, astrologically, is kind of about connecting that fiery, you know, focused will with our emotional guidance system. And using, how does this, okay, so I'm thinking I'm going to direct my energy this way. How does that feel? What is my mood like suddenly when I'm thinking about that? What happens to my mood? Do I feel like I'm having to shove something down and say, no, I don't feel that way, I'm going to go forward anyway? Or are we in alignment? Because the fact is, if you're feeling something and you're suppressing it, you're instantly out of alignment. And true will is in alignment with divine will. That's how it works. So your emotions are the indicator as to whether or not you're in alignment with it, right? So, you know, we have this idea that we have to disengage our hearts and just become rational. And, you know, I've had discussions with people who say, well, if you're a surgeon, you have to do that. Certainly, you have to, like, be, you know, reasonable and, you have to, you know, disengage your emotions and simply work on the object that's in front of you with your, you know, your mind. And I would say, you know, I'm not a surgeon, but I would say that the feeling sense that as an intelligence also would probably, cutting anything off about ourselves at any time is using only part of who we are in any moment doing anything. So if we're having, you know, we're doing this, let's say I'm a surgeon and I'm working on something and I've got this feeling that this just isn't correct, even though rationally it looks like what I'm doing is absolutely correct. I should cut here, I should remove this, and I've got this feeling tone, my mood is changing, something's going on here, and I just know something doesn't feel right, something doesn't smell right, so to speak. That's sort of something people use to describe when the emotional guidance system is off. Something doesn't smell right. Generally, in surgery, maybe there's all that kind of stuff. Probably why people wear face masks. Anyway, I'm going off on a different thing. But, you know, something doesn't feel right. Maybe there's something to that in that moment. So just thinking about this kind of stuff anyway, with will, the emotions, and all this, with this full moon sort of coming into this culminating sort of phase with the full moon. And then Jupiter and Venus making a conjunction in Leo. So this is Venus, and well, let me talk about this too. This is really interesting, is that Jupiter and Venus in the sky right now, you can see them in the western sky. It's really beautiful. I can see them out my bedroom window every night. It's quite a light show. And they're going to just get closer and closer up until June 30th. So be on the lookout for that. It's really beautiful. But astrologically, they're also getting closer together. You can see this happening in the sky. And Jupiter and Venus are both considered by the medieval astrologers to be benefics. They're there to help us and expand and bring love and beauty and meaning and all that kind of stuff. And when they get together, it's supposed to be especially benefic, especially beneficial. In Leo, the sign of the heart, the sign of expansion, this is a... moment where it's getting harder and harder, if you're in resistance to this, it's getting harder and harder to keep your heart closed, because we're finding, perhaps, how this is to our detriment. You know, again, we sometimes, I think, have the idea that keeping a closed heart keeps us safer. And with all this energy in Cancer right now, especially Mars in Cancer, there is a concern about safety, protection, boundaries, mine, my tribe, my house, my stuff. And so we want to do that. We want to protect that. But Jupiter and Venus together open up the heart, and the sign of the heart, which is Leo, when we close our hearts, we become brittle. And when we're brittle, we're not flexible. And when we're not flexible, we break. So actually, even though we may feel safer, we're kind of not in a lot of ways. We sort of get ourselves from the inside through unhappiness and through separation and through disengagement, lack of integration, and things just don't feel good when our hearts are closed. We just sort of skim on the surface of life. So this aspect coming into play is saying, hey, you know, Jupiter would say, there's a whole world out there. Venus would talk about love in relation to that whole world out there. How about, you know, peering out from that shell a little bit, moving outside of your own neighborhood, so to speak, whether it's physical or your own emotional neighborhood too, right? And take a look at what's going on in the out there, and how can you engage with it in a really heartfelt kind of way. It doesn't mean you have to be stupid and tell everybody everything about your life and hope that they treat you nicely. I mean, like, when we are, again, it's all about alignment. I mean, this is what it always comes back down to, around to, is alignment. When we're aligned with ourselves, we're just able to walk in the world with confidence. And not what masquerades as confidence, which is protectiveness, fear, even anger. You know, I was talking about anger earlier. Anger is either masked fear or amped fear, but it's still a fear-based emotion. We're still trying to not feel, and again, sometimes this is like if you're in immediate danger, this makes sense, you know. It's you know, anger is supposed to occur when there's a moment where we're seriously threatened. Cancer is the sign, its shadow side is about perceiving threats that aren't there. The United States itself is a Cancer, and that seems to be one of the shadow sides to this country, is we're always looking for the threat to our borders and, you know, finding threatening things all over the rest of the world, and we're going out and managing everybody else, you know? We're probably the most threatening, you know, entity out there as a nation for everybody else, right? So this is sort of the way that Cancer energy, especially with Mars in it, can sort of warp. And again, it lacks flexibility, it gets militarized, and we can get militarized with this kind of energy. So the Jupiter-Venus conjunction is reminding us that's not, when we create that kind of energy, that's when it becomes necessary. You know, defense is the first act of war. It's a quote that I love from a person named Byron Katie. You know, she said, defense is the first act of war. If you're in, you know, the mindset where you need to defend yourself, you know, before anything has even happened, then you're just perceiving that something has happened. Maybe it hasn't yet. It's in your own mind that this has occurred. You're creating war, and you're creating war within yourself. I came across this. I was invited to a something about, you know, as a ritual to promote peace, and the whole thing basically was a the invitation was like a long. There's a long written piece to the invitation about how there's enemies out there, and there's people that are trying to cause war, and there are people that are out to do this kind of thing. And then we're going to do a ritual about peace. And I thought, how in the world is that peaceful? You've now separated yourself from those people, which is, again, this is the shadow side of Cancer, those people. We're this tribe and they're that tribe. So you've now separated yourself, and now you've created an enemy outside of yourself that you're going to fight with peace. That doesn't work, people. It doesn't work. And the main thing that you're exposing when you say something like that is that you have an enemy within you that you're fighting. You have your own adversary. The full moon's going to be in Capricorn. Capricorn, the tarot card associated with Capricorn, is the devil. This is the adversary. This is also the trickster. The devil is our shadow side. The devil is the part of ourselves that we don't like to admit, but it's also the part of ourselves where the most juice is, you know? It's our lust, it's our anger, it's our desires that are, you know, off limits that we're not supposed to have. Isn't that exciting? That's the devil. And so again, you know, coming back to what I was saying earlier, we're gonna come at this with humor. To really navigate this territory well and not take ourselves so seriously, or the threats that we think are out there so seriously. Half the time that we're threatened by what somebody else has to say or what we think they're doing, it's not even accurate. It's actually our perception of it due to our own insecurities or things that we are not wanting to admit about ourselves. So when we imagine that we are good and we are peaceful and there are those people who are not. And this is another thing that I see all the time. I'm feeling this Mars and Sun thing, right? So I'm saying more, I'm doing more smack talk. But this is, you know, I'll see like, you know, spiritual people who send out these memes on Facebook, they come through my feed about letting go of toxic people. And I'm thinking, what a toxic thing to do, you know, to write this meme about toxic people that you need to, why would you call another human being toxic? You are being toxic in the moment that you are saying that about another human being, that they are the enemy, and you need to fight them with your goodness, and you need to advise other people and yourself that to let go of toxic people. You are toxic. You are toxic in that moment. When we are peaceful, we're peaceful. When we are full of love, we're full of love. Period. We're not putting other people down in those moments. That is not an act of peace. That is not an act of love. So getting aware of this kind of stuff as we're moving through life can really help us get integrated. And it's funny. I mean, when we notice like what we're really doing and thinking, I'm gonna achieve peace by talking about all those enemies out of there and stoking everybody's paranoia, but they should come to my ritual of peace so we can feel good about ourselves and generate peace. That was amazing to me. And it also, you know, made me think this is just my own thing about like, how is it that I'm doing that? What is this reflecting for me as I'm looking at that? What are some ways in which I'm like, aha, you know? You're this and I'm just doing, you know, I'm just saying, or I'm just doing, or I never hurt anybody, you know? We all do. We're all doing things. So I'm not saying this so we all feel guilty about all our stuff. What I'm saying is that we can have a sense of humor about ourselves and we can open our hearts more and really be, ask when you're doing something, is this a loving thing to do? Is this a peaceful thing to do? You know? Is it loving and peaceful toward myself, first of all? With this energy, it's very volatile, very, very volatile. And this is the fun part too. This is like high octane. We're moving towards this full moon. We've got the Venus and Jupiter in Leo and fire. We've got the Sun and Mars conjunct. They're both fiery, will-oriented planets. This is the time to take action. Even if it's like, you know, I don't know if I should just, if you've been thinking and sitting on something for a long time, take some action on it. Just, even if you make a mistake, it's okay. This energy is moving. This is not sit and contemplate energy. This is, let me say though, this is energy that needs balance. I mean, you know, yeah, I'm not advising you don't think and just do. What I'm advising is that follow your intuition on things. Trust yourself. Tune into your heart center. Take that moment. Have that moment. And then get out of your chair and try something new. Ask your heart, what is it that you want? What is it you'd like to do? What are you curious about? What would make you feel alive, heart? What would make me feel alive? What risk might I like to take now that might make me feel enlivened? Even if, so it doesn't go well, maybe. Or maybe it's the best thing you've ever done. Or maybe that particular thing, you know, maybe an immediate manifestation doesn't go well, but somehow it opens a door down the road that you would never have expected. This is a time to move. That's what time it is. It's time to do things and grow and move. So, and then joke about it. We need jokes. You know, if you do something, you fall on your face. That's hilarious. Wonderful. Get up and try something else. Here we go. Those of you who are in the Northern Hemisphere, it's summertime. All this Leo energy, it's time to have fun. Now, the moon's going to be in Scorpio this weekend. So, we're going to be feeling sensitive, too. So, you know, there's that. Yeah, we're needing to simultaneously tune in to ourselves and take correct action. Let's pull a card here. All right, ready? I'm gonna pull from the Rider deck today. I love this deck. It's the basic deck, you know. Love this one, Thoth deck. I have so many decks. All right, ready? Wait, that one didn't feel right. Pull a card. Wonder what it is. Oh, this guy. All right, see, this is what I'm talking about. This is Cancer, right? This is, this card doesn't necessarily correspond to Cancer, but this is what I'm talking about, the Cancer energy. This is the Four of Pentacles. Look at this dude. He's hanging on to that thing. He's got his city behind him, but you know what? It doesn't really look very, I mean, how's that city look to you? Does it look, like a great place to live? It's kind of bleak, really, to me, but it's like a secure place. So he's kind of like, you know, I've got all my stuff. I've got myself together, right? He's sort of smiling. He's kind of like, he's all right. You know, he's secure. And then, yeah, the city in the back, you know, there's some parks, city parks in there. So he's all right. He's good, right? Four of Pentacles. So this is like fortifying your territory. So I think this has to do, you know, this card, this guy in the card sort of reminds me of the Emperor, whose number is also four in the tarot. And that has to do with authority and directed authority, direct authority to the right places. It's very masculine energy. He's got a crown on his head. He's a sovereign, so he's got a crown on his head. But he's not looking too terribly excited about things, and he looks lonely to me too. But he's got his stuff. He can't really move. You know, he's got his feet on the pentacles. He's holding that one. The other one's on his head. I mean, he doesn't have a lot of freedom of movement. So perhaps this speaks to that sort of dynamic right now. Like, of wanting the urge to keep things safe and keep our boundaries and keep what we have. And then also, like, the discomfort that can come with that, where we don't have as much movement as we might desire. And so a crab, I think of with all this energy in Cancer, you know, a crab keeps its shell, its home, with it all the time. And it moves around like that. It swims in the water and it doesn't leave its home, but it can travel anyway. I think of that as us being able to feel secure in our own sense of boundaries and also be able to navigate the world. So when we don't trust ourselves and we don't trust our own sense of boundaries, what can happen is we don't want to leave the house because we're afraid we're going to go out and make mistakes, or we're going to let people in, and we're not going to be able to say no to things. We're not going to be able to say yes to things, maybe. We're going to somehow get thrown off center, have our boundaries crossed, and just wish we had stayed at home. And the way that we know what our boundaries are is, again, by our feeling nature. So you know when somebody's either crossed your boundary by overextending themselves into your territory, by how you feel. You get an oogs in your solar plexus, or you don't feel good in your heart, or you get angry, maybe. That's a signal that your boundary is being crossed. Or an outgoing boundary cross can also occur, where someone pulls away from you when there's either an explicit or implicit connection that you had expected to be there, and that suddenly seems to be gone, and you weren't expecting that, and you were counting on this person in some way, or there was a trust, perhaps, that was broken in this way, a betrayal of some kind. An outgoing boundary cross of abandonment and withdrawal, we'll feel that also with solar plexus stuff and some anger. So I think this card has to do with being aware of those boundaries, like a crab has the shell wherever she goes, but also being able to have the freedom of movement to go out and do things in the world. And our boundaries may shift and change, but we have to be able to trust ourselves enough So we don't just have to hang on, we can sort of get fluid, like the water sign of Cancer, like the moon being in Scorpio, fluidity, and move with grace and elegance emotionally and also just in our lives in general. So with that, I'm gonna complete this report. Again, visit my website at aprilsastrology.com. I look forward to hearing from you. Sign up for my mailing list, and we'll see you next time. Happy full moon. Take care.